Welcome back to the Nullified Take, where we have the TNT takes for you on Survivor 42. Another season has come and gone, and a new winner has been crowned. Congratulations to Marianne for outwitting, outlasting, and outplaying everyone on the Fijian island for 26 days. Now it's time to look at the five players that I believe earned their ticket to return to the island. Full disclaimer, I love big move players or characters, and therefore you shouldn't expect to see many passive players on my wish list. As I break down these five players that I would like to see return, I will also talk about the theme that they would most likely fit into on a returnee season. Player number one, Drea Wheeler. By the end of the season, she was my favorite player. I really enjoyed her cutthroat approach to this game. I also related to her fighting spirit, which I'm sure she earned from being self-employed and running her own business. She played the game hard from day one, which made me fearful that she would be an early boot on the Ikka tribe. This, however, enabled her to find the amulet on day one, and collecting more unique advantages this season than anyone else or prior to her in the history of the show. Drea had no problem turning her backs against allies from the pre-merge tribe. She turned her back against Rox and Romeo straight after the merge. I believe this was a flaw in her game, but one that she could fix prior to her return. No one wins this show completely on their own. But in some ways, I think credit should also be given to the likes of Hai and Omara for convincing her that she had a new home and a place within their alliance. If Drea ever returned for another season, the theme I would most like to see her on would be Heroes vs. Villains 2 as a villain. But she also fit many other themes such as second chances, game changes, or even fans versus favourites. The second player would be Lindsay Dolashewicz. I'm sorry, Lindsay, I'm probably mispronouncing that last name, but Lindsay is someone that I would like to see, even though she had a slow start for me this season, and I wasn't fully for or against her prior to the merge. She was probably the most bland personality for me in these early stages in the Taku tribe, but Marianne winning this season is also something that pushed her up on my top five, since, spoiler alert, I don't really want to see any winners return unless it's in an all-winners season or a winners versus runner-up season moving forward. I do believe that when winners return to play the show, they normally are just cannon fodder to the season and people will always go and vote them out first since they've had their moment to shine and they have $1 million in the bank. Lindsay did play a great social game in the tribe stage of the game, but she was overshadowed by Jonathan in the team portion. He obviously was the strongest player in that tribe, and a lot of the edit really revolved around Jonathan winning these challenges for the Taku tribe. She, however, did come to play after the merge when she won two immunities when she went up against Jonathan head-to-head, and she was his biggest competition, even in those wins that Jonathan had. I believe Lindsay came in second quite a few times. Let's not forget that Lindsay was also someone that was forced to play in the do-or-die twist, which showed her competitive spirit and the fact that she would never want to stand back from trying to win, and we as fans really love seeing players not sit out for food when it comes to immunities and taking the game seriously, which I believe that competitive spirit that Lindsay had is something that should be admired. Like Marianne said at that tribal council, don't let this be something that changes you if you do go out on the do or die twist. Now, thankfully for us, that didn't happen and she did choose the right box. Still can't believe we have a twist where someone can go home based on three boxes that they have to pick from, but luckily that wasn't her end in the game, and I think Lindsay would still have that very competitive edge to her if she was ever to come back and play this game. Lindsay also impressed me when she influenced Omara's decision and even came up with the plan to blindside Drea, who was the biggest threat in the game at that stage with the most advantages. She had a massive role to play, and I think it showed that she was more of the strategist behind the move than what Omara even was. She told Omara to get the idol from Mike, which would enable them to make this move on Drea when she asked for Mike's idol. To me, Lindsay has Sarah Lucina upside, and I rate Sarah highly as a great player of this game, so it should be seen as a compliment. I would love to see Lindsay return to partake in a second chance season the most, but she could also probably follow in Sarah's footsteps and return in a Game Changers season, since that worked out so well for Sarah. Okay, so we're heading to player number three now, and I want to throw in my wildcard pick of the bunch. For those of you that saw my top five for the Australian Survivor season, Blood vs. Water, you would know that I like to throw a wildcard into my top fives. Now, for me, this player was probably the wildcard pick actually for the casting team when they put this cast together, and they will also be my wildcard pick here for this top five players that I want to see return. And it's going to be no one other than the man, the myth, the legend, Mr. Roxroy himself. I feel like I may have enjoyed him more than most, even though fans did seem to soften on him a little bit after his exile episode, in which he had to make the decision on breaking the hourglass. I feel like Rox came from the past in a time machine, and that he was never supposed to play season 42. He is a forgotten character from the early days of Survivor. The person who goes out there and that thinks doing work around camp and actually surviving while being the provider will get you the win in the end. For most people, I think this is infuriating to watch, and they normally don't like this character. For me, I don't mind it as much, especially in a season where you have got so many game body strategist type of players now, as the new season gets more and more fans on the show. I find it extremely refreshing to have this player with this old school approach that is so different to the rest, and at times can be seen as almost clueless to the game that is being played around them. And I really enjoyed seeing Roxroy, and it was in some ways almost nostalgic to see a player such as him come out there and order people around camp, getting them to pick up, you know, firewood, go do certain chores, and then people getting really annoyed with him on TV was something I actually personally really enjoyed. Plus, Roxroy seems like someone with a massive heart, and I think that playing this game once may have opened his eyes to the type of strategy required to win this game. Let's not forget that he would have had time to see others respond to him after the season by watching the show back. He would have seen how High received him when he came over and tried to create this male alliance. He would have seen how Swati and others spoke of him, or Tori behind his back, when he was around camp. And I think that Roxroy is an intelligent enough person to take this on board and then to change his gameplay if he was ever to be given a second chance out there. And like I said, he's just not that cookie cutter personality on the island, so he'll be someone that I would enjoy as someone that's going to bring something different to a returning season. In reality, I don't think Rox will come back, and he may want to put Survivor behind him, since it never really looked like he did it for any kind of fame. His whole story was one of personal development, but I hope I'm wrong about this and that we do see Rox out there again. I think the theme or themes that would suit him most would probably be old school versus new school, and it would be quite ironic to have him in a season where he represents the new school season while playing an old school style of game. Player number four. It has to be Omar, right? Let's be honest, Omar dominated this season like no one else did. It's funny because Omar is a great example of someone that could have been edited out of the show if his moves didn't land. He played from the back and suggested moves to others for the majority of the game. But this strategy was extremely effective, and his biggest move and example of this playing from the back style of gameplay was when he broke the alliance between High and Mike. Him telling the lie to Mike about High, calling Mike his puppet, was extremely well-timed. When Mike was at the reward receiving love from home and vulnerable, it showed that Omar really knew how to persuade someone, and more importantly, exactly when to do so. Here on the Nullified Take, Omar was by far our biggest favourite week in and week out in our power rankings, and we kept ranking him at number one week after week, to the point where, towards the end of the season, he had three times the amount of points compared to anybody else of this season. Personally, I loved Omar's willingness to be devious and blindsiding people. He leaned into the game and did so in a way that it was never about any personal reasons when he took out his victims. He truly looked like someone who understood that this was a game that was meant to be played hard and devious, which we as fans really love to see. His only mistake was that he became survivor confident at the end of the game, which ultimately led to his blindside on the island. Omar to me would best fit a second chance season because he came so close before falling short, or even a Heroes vs Villains 2 season as a villain, and he would, similar to the others from this season like Drea, be a likable villain, someone that I would want to shout for if he was to return in such a tribe. Lastly, but not least, I have to make a very tough decision between two people who I really enjoyed seeing play this game. It also just so happens that they were also the two people that went up against each other at the end of the season, making fire. Now, I know for most it would be easy to exclude Jonathan from this list, but Mike and Jonathan are both players that I enjoyed watching. I think I will kind of lean towards Mike here, winning it out over Jonathan for me when it comes to someone that I would like to see return, and my main reason is that I think Jonathan is someone that is better suited to the challenge and that he could become one of the great players of that game should he make the crossover. Now, Mike, on the other hand, was a great player of this season. In my opinion, he probably on paper played the second best overall game throughout the whole season compared to Omar, who played the best. However, he was not great at marketing himself to the jury at the end. We all know that you can have a superior product on the market, but if people don't know about how good it was and you don't sell it accordingly, you might not strike the right audience that will buy into that product to begin with. And I feel like Mike, if you're ever out there, you've never worked in marketing, probably a good thing. Mike had such a great social game out there though that it meant he pretty much always knew where the votes were going to go. Obviously excluding that first vote, he was not involved in his number one Jenny getting voted out, but a lot of things went wrong and I feel like more the twists of the game and an old school fan like Mike coming into this game, not being aware of this new school game and the types of twists that were going to play out, you know, I don't blame him too much for that first vote not being in the ins there. I mean, who would have known by picking up an idol, for instance, you would lose your vote until you could activate it because it was never done before this season. And he didn't see season 41. Mike had the ability, though, to connect with everyone. And he also had a lot of control when it came to voting people out. He is larger than life character, which is something I enjoy about this cast as a whole. And I really enjoyed him losing his idol, having to talk about football and soccer and his love for the game when he didn't even know what the game was about. I even really enjoyed how emotionally he played at times, talking about people, you know, and their betrayal and how dare they turn their back on him. It was good to see someone that had some emotion in their gameplay. It was evident even until the very end going into the final three that he was by far the best narrator of this season. Mike, to me, will be a better player if he made it to the final again. However, I do think he would have a massive target on his back should he return based on the social game that he played and also people knowing that he can turn his back on those that are closest to him like he did to Hai and also Lydia when it came to the merge. He could easily play in a second chances season, a fans versus favorites season, or even a heroes versus villains 2 season. So many themes could fit around Mike. The only issue here is obviously Mike is 56 or 57 already, so maybe if he did return, it would have to be sooner rather than later. Now, that's my take on the players from this latest season that I would like to see return. Who do you agree on and who do you disagree on? Who would you pick as your 5 players from this season? Leave a comment below and please remember to like and subscribe and even share it to those that also love Survivor. It does help this channel grow and for it to get recognized within the YouTube algorithms. As always, thank you so much for watching us this season as we covered on the podcast and recapped every week of this season. We will be back for next season, but in the meantime, I am lining up some special guests to do off-season content with, so keep an eye on the channel. We will be back sooner rather than later. Catch you next time.